Okay. Welcome everyone to the virtual afternoon session of the conference. It's my pleasure to introduce Liviana Polmisano from Durham University that will talk on stability of two-dimensional non-trivial dynamics. Please.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation. And I really apologize for not being present to the other talks. It's not that, you know, it's just I'm in the US and so the time change is quite bad. But I know that you had a celebration yesterday for Felix and I would like you to join to the happy birthday. So happy birthday, Felix.
Really. Thank you.
Okay, so now let's talk math. So what do I want to say? Let me see. Okay, so let me introduce the problem. So we have, let's start really from simple stuff. We have a dynamical system, so manifold and the map acting on it. And so one of the aim of dynamics is to understand the long-term behavior of the system. So in particular, this information are contained in what is called the attractor of the system that I'm going to denote in this way, AF. So the attractor of the system is the set where most orbits spend most of the time. So this is going to give us information about the long-term behavior of the system. So one of the problems that I'm going to address today is existence of attractors. And now, of course, the simplest possible attractor is just a closed orbit, but most of the time these attractors are very complicated, have fractured structures, or they are chaotic. So let's see what can we say. And now, suppose that now we have two systems, and suppose that we know about the existence of the of attractors AF and AG. So the next question is try to understand which is the topology of these attractors, in the sense that there exists H an homeomorphism. Such that G composed with H is equal to H composed with F. So what about the topology of attractors? So this is a sort of the next natural question. As soon as you know about the existence, one will have to understand the topology of an attractor. And a bit more further, we can say, suppose that now we are in the space of system, how is the set of systems which has the same topology, so which are conjugated on their attractor, for which their attractor has the same topology. So this is what is called stability. What about the stability? How the attractors survive in the space of system? So what the second question that I'm going to address today is about stability of attractors. Okay, so let me be a bit more precise about what I mean about the stability of attractors with a very simple example, the simplest possible example, the one of the simplest example that we can make. Of course, we have to go in dimension one, and we consider the Arnold family. So what do we have? We have that F A omega A of X, what is omega X plus I sinus of 2 pi X. So we take mod one, so in the circle. What do we know? We know that, of course, so now what we have? We have here A and omega. And when A is zero, for A zero, these are all the rotation. All the rotations. And what we know is that for A, if the rotation number of FA omega is irrational, then the attractor of FA omega is the whole circle. And now what I want to say is now we fix when, let's say, omega zero, somewhere here. So we have the rotation, that point we have the rotation, we take it irrational. We have an irrational rotation. Then what do we know is that for all A, there exists an F omega. For all A, we can find an F omega, such that the attractor of this F omega is the same as the attractor then the rotation. So in particular, there is a curve of points corresponding to map with the same topology. So the guys, so the annual maps with the same topology, they form a curve. And now if you take all the rational numbers, these curves, they will form a lamination.
Let me ask, there is omega times x or omega plus x? You are in additive notation.
Yes, I'm sorry. Yes, okay. Thank you. Yes. Yeah, this is just to give you, thank you. So this is just to give you an idea of if you consider this family is a two-parameter family, the corresponding to irrational rotations, the maps with the same topology, they form, so they have a codimension one, they form curves, they form a lamination. And the intervals, the open intervals, they correspond to rational rotations. And now this is a very simple example, a very basic example, codimension two in the parameter space. So we can put this example in a bigger space of circle diffeomorphism. We can embed all these in the space of circle diffeomorphism. And in this case, so the Arnold family, the guys which are the same topology, again, they will have curves, they will be curves, but all the circle diffeomorphism with the same topology, they will form a codimension one length. So in the space of circle diffeomorphism, there are a codimension one manifold of guys with the same topology. The topology of circle diffeomorphism, we can say that has a codimension one nature. Okay, so this was just an example to make you understand what I mean about stability. So about this persistency of topology of attractors. So the case of circle diffeomorphism is understood. So the situation is clear. In dimension one, it is a lot of things still needs to be done in this direction for many systems, but allow me to say that things are sort of we know what to expect. Now let's go in dimension two. So let's try to bring this problem in dimension two. Let's see what we can say. Of course, the first problem which arises is that these are much more complicated systems and the attractors themselves can be much more complicated. That we can have, for example, chaotic attractors. So there are a lot of different kinds of attractors which can show up. So in particular, we will concentrate on anon maps. So the anon family. So this is the anon family. So again, two parameter family. A and B are the two parameters. And so it seems to be in dimension one, we have the quadratic family and just the dimension on the quadratic family in dimension two. So it's a degree two polynomial in dimension two, but still with a very rich dynamics. So Anon in the 70, he saw with the experimental computer that in correspondence to A equal to 1.4 and B equal to 0.3, this map actually had a chaotic attractor, what he called the strange attractor. Of course, this was a computer experiment, so people at the time didn't believe that this could have been true. They more expected that this was a period of Newhouse, infinitely many things. So people would expect that what Newhouse saw was was due to a computer error. And what it really was very, very long close orbit that eventually will go back to itself. But 20 years later, Benedict Carlson, right. Let me write BC because I'm going to use their construction during the lecture many times. So let me say BC. When I say BC, I mean Benedict Carlson. They proved that actually the strange attractor really exists for a positive big measure set of parameters. And so that there is really a chaotic attractor appearing in this sort of, at the first look, very simple family. The dimension, the polynomial dimension, the degree two polynomial. So the previous known example of chaos was in the Lorentz system, which is already more complicated to state, a bit more difficult to study, complicated to state system, so based on three differential equations. Okay, and now let me start to be a bit more formal. And if we want to go in this direction, we need to know what is a strange attractor. So I'm going to give you the definition that Benedict Carlson gave. Let M be a manifold. Now F from M to M, an open set U in M is called a trapping region if the closure of the made image of U is contained in U. Now, an attractor in the sense of Conway is lambda, the intersection of the image of this trapping region. Now we say, so the attractor lambda is called topologically transitive if it contains a dense orbit. Now, if lambda contains a dense orbit which satisfies the Kolekman condition, so also Kolekman is something that I'm going to use often. So let me write a CE. Whenever I CE, I mean Kolekman. So the Kolekman conditions. Then lambda is called the strange attractor. So strange attractor is the Conley attractor with a transited orbit with which satisfy the Kolekman conditions. So if somebody doesn't know what is a Kolekman condition, suppose that we take a point Z, so is a point for which along the orbit we see a lot of expansion. So what it means is if we take a vector in the tangent space, what do we have? The derivative grow exponentially fast, at least exponentially fast. Okay. Large constant. So this gives you a bit the idea of what chaos means, in the sense if you take two points really nearby, because of this expansion, they will get far apart very, very fast, which is the contrary of what it happens for sinks. If you take a attractive periodic orbit, if you take two points, they will get very close, very fast. And sort of you can imagine that expansion, so this getting far apart very fast, plus transitivity, so getting this point coming back densely everywhere, makes sort of the dynamics difficult to explain and to understand. Okay, but that's what it is. And now, let's continue with... what we wanted to say. Let's go back to our previous problem of existence of attractors and their stability in the anon family. So I'm going to discuss, I'm going to do sort of a summary of part of what we know about the attractors existing in the anon family and their stability. So here FKB is the anon family. And now we want existence and we want stability. So what about the existence of attractors in the anon family? As we just said, Benedict Arleson, they proved that for a positive set of parameters, there are maps with a chaotic attractor, with a strange attractor. So this is BC. Of course, I'm sorry for not being very precise with the citation. So there is Moraviana. So let me just concentrate on the anon family. But of course, there's been a lot of development. I should cite Misurevich also. I'm sorry, don't get angry at me if I didn't mention your name yet. Okay, and then there are parameters such that the corresponding map has one attractive periodic orbit, so a sink. And this is very, I will not need a note to the old result. Now one can have maps with, okay, this is my, I don't know why I'm using big and small. So with actually infinitely many sinks attracting periodic orbit, and this is, let me write a new house in the family, probably would be more correct to say Robinson, sort of what is known as the new house phenomena, so the coexistence of infinitely many sinks. So there are maps with one period doubling attractor, and this is De Carvalho, Ljubic, Martens. A period doubling attractor is a counter attractor. The dynamics in the counter attractor is conjugated to a dyadic machine. And now we also know with Michael, we proved that there are maps with actually two coexisting in the anon family. One map you can find, actually for a positive measure set, two strange attractors. And this is Benedict's myself. And actually I proved that in the same map, you can find also two POW attractors. Okay, so this is, there are also other coexisting phenomena known, but let me stop here and let me now concentrate on the stability because I'm mostly interested in understanding the stability of this phenomena. So how is the topology of these attractors and how it survives? So let's start from the simplest possible case, which is a sink of a certain period. We know that the sink is a stable object, the most possible stable object. So it survives in open set with is a period. So you move parameters in an open set, the sink is going to survive. So let me write that as a codimension zero nature. And now, what about the period doubling? The period doubling, we actually know that they survive in a codimension one manifold. So in the two parameter space, we have A and B. So at the boundary of chaos, there is a codimension one manifold of Guy with a period doubling attractor. So and this is the same people, De Carvalho, Ljubic, Martens, they will prove, also proved that there is a codimension one manifold. And now, what about infinitely many things? So infinitely many things, so we are talking, what are infinitely many, we are talking about coexisting, coexistence of infinitely many things of higher and higher order. Now, one thing is a stable object, it's very stable, it survives in an open neighborhood. But now we are talking, now one expects that when the period of the thing gets larger, then the neighborhood where it survives gets smaller. And now we are talking about infinitely many things of larger and larger period. So there is not really way to expect that they would survive all together with their combinatorics in some way. But actually we proved that they form codimension to lamination. And this is with Michael, Marco. So what does it mean, this codimension to lamination? So people which were in my talk, previous talk, they know about that in the sense that I would give this preview, initial overview, and then I would explain about this lamination. Now I'm just going to give you a picture and then we move forward. So what is this lamination? You have this AB, and the points with infinitely many things in the AB plane is, they are just points. These are points, nuanced points with infinitely many things. But now if you add one or two or any new number of parameters, these infinitely many things, these points with infinitely many things, all together with their combinatorics, they will start to move in codimension one manifold. So, and now all these points, they move in a codimension, I'm sorry, two manifold, forming together a codimension two laminations. So imagine these infinitely many things with their combinatorics moving. So for example, if you take, and you can add any number of parameters, if you take the space of polynomial of any degree, you are going to see this codimension two manifold. Okay, so this is true also for the nuance phenomena in, so it's exactly for bigger families, with polynomial families, actually also in C2. We proved it with the PhD students at Stony Brook, Tao. Okay, and actually I proved that the same happens, this codimension two lamination appear also for the two period, coexisting two period doubling, there is a codimension two lamination. Again, these are these two period doubling with their combinatorics, they move, you can see them in higher family as a codimension two lamination. And on each leaf of the laminations, the combinatorics is always the same, it's not changing. Okay, and now, now the new story starts, which is about what about stability of strange attractors. We know that there is a positive Abegg measure set of them. Actually, there is a cloud of them around A equal to 2. There is a cloud of guys. But when you take now two points, they will have different combinatorics. So there is no, in the Benedict-Carlson construction, there is no control of the combinatorics, in the sense that if you, in this sense, there is a cloud, a positive Abegg measure set of points, but when you take two different points, the two attractors, they will have a different topology. Okay, so what we would like to do at this point is trying to understand the topology of strange attractors and eventually their stability. Of course, this starts to be a bit complicated, and because these are very, they are chaotic objects. So one would expect that when you change parameters, you destroy them very, very easily. And indeed, this is what it happens. But okay, let me tell you, I'm going to tell you something that I know and something that I conjecture. So I'm going to say some theorems, something that I understand, something that where I want to get and why I think that it might be true. First of all, how do we do that? So how do we approach this problem? How can we study the topology of strange attractors? As usual, we take inspiration from something that we understand well, which is the dimension one. So let's consider the case of the quadratic family, dimension one. dimension one. And there is one point in the quaternary family which plays a crucial role, which is the critical point. So there is a critical point. And in dimension one, the critical point is very well defined. So there is the point with zero derivative. And now, and then what do? We define the coding map. So we have a left interval, we have a right interval. Using left and right interval, we can see where the orbit of this point will go. So on the left, on the right. So we can define the coding map, which send each point to the coding of. And this is in the, it can be either left or right. So in particular, we are interested in the coding of the critical point. And now we say that two systems are topologically the same. G, sorry. Okay, so two systems are the topologically the same. If this is not really correct, there is something else there, but just to give you an idea of how to look for combinatorics. So if the coding of the corresponding critical point or the critical point of F is the same as the coding of the critical point of G. Again, this is not formally super correct, but just to give you an idea. So we have this critical point, which is our preferred point, and we look at this orbit, if they will go in the left or right intervals. We write the sequence, and we look at the needed sequence. And now we would like to do the same in dimension two. So first problem, what about critical points? So in dimension, so the anon family is this invertible maps. So the determinant of the matrix of the derivative is always non-zero. So this definition, it doesn't have any meaning in dimension two. So we, as first thing, we do have to try to understand how to define critical points. Of course, I'm not the first one which tried to do that. There have been many attempts. In the direction of defining critical points. And the definition that I'm going to give you now today is inspired by Bennis Carlson. And I will not be able to give you a formal definition because this might require the whole lecture, but I would like to try to give you an idea of what I mean about critical points in the anon family. With two pictures. So let me try. It's the first time that I give this talk. So let me try. Let's see. So again, we are in the anon family, two parameter family. Let me write here B and A. The other picture was the contrary, but okay. Yeah, these two parameter family. And now, so we have a saddle point. So we have a stable manifold and then unstable. So this is the stable manifold, this is the unstable manifold. And now we take a fundamental domain in the unstable manifold. So this is called C, so it's a fundamental domain in the unstable manifold. Now we take a point here, and we suppose that, so this point has a property that there exists an interval, omega n, an interval around it. We can use different colors. So this is the interval, omega n, and there is a time, tn, such that this interval come back after the time tn as a nook. Allow me to say this word, I will try to make sense of this later. So this interval come back, something like that. And now, what it happens from the point of view of the parameter space, in the parameter space fixed B, there is an interval AN. So there is an omega N, a time TN, and an interval in the parameter space AN, with the property that if you go from the bottom to the top of AN, this critical point runs through all the fundamental domain. So while you are moving here from the bottom to the top of AN, your critical value is actually moving through all the fundamental domain. Okay, so I wanted to give you this picture because if you open Benedict Carlson, just look at the picture, you will see this picture quite often appearing. But now I would like to make sense of this picture, and in particular the next picture we try to make sense of this picture, in particular to explain these two things which are very really not formal that I said. What is a nuke, what I mean with a nuke, and what it means to move. What it means the critical value to move. In order to do that, I'm going to use a holomorphic structure. And now I will do that. So consider that you have the unknown family. So for B small, you can the first, I'm going to make a picture of the first return map for the unknown family for B small. And this looks something like that. Again, now our fundamental domain is going to be a bidisk. I'm going to look at the real slice of this. And now we have an unstable manifold and unstable manifold. And now what do? I take this bidisk and I consider a partition of this bidisk by strips. I call all this strip S. Imagine that these strips are the same than the left and right of the dimension one. So in dimension one, we had just left and right, and now we have many strips. I will call them all them S, but one. I will call again, let me use another color. One strip I'm going to call C. And all the others are called S. And which is the properties of these strips, is that each of these S strip come back as a full vertical strip. So this is the image of one of these. Each of these S strip, they come back in this way. So imagine it's contracted and then enlarged. And what about the C? So the C come back as a degree two strip. So this is the meaning of the hook. When I said before, the hook is that there is one strip in the fundamental domain which come back in as a degree two strip. So, and as you see, I needed a holomorphic structure in order to make sense of this hook. And now, and now we take a point. Let me enlarge this picture. I would like to have, so what do we have here? So we have this. So we enlarge this picture, we go back to. Okay. We have this C. C strip in the fundamental domain, and now we take a point, see, and we go again to our definition. There exists this omega n. Now this omega n is a disk. Before was an interval, now is a disk. And what does it mean? So how that it come back as a nuke, it means that the boundary of this disk will come back on the boundary of C, it will wrap around C twice. So what do we have? We have this disk, omega n, which goes after the time tn in the strip C, wrapping twice. And now we take the projection of this disk, we get the disk. And now the map, if you look at the map from here to here, is a degree two map. So in particular, there is a critical point here that there is a critical value here. So what does it mean that this critical value run? Now I'm trying to give you meaning of what it means that this critical value is moving. So what I was trying to explain you here about this moving. It means that now if we take there exists an AN in the parameter space, such that when you move on the disk AN, your critical value moves all over the disk B. So this is about this, give you an idea of what is this moving. Okay, so this that I called critical point at this moment is what Benedict Carlson called approximate critical point. Is not really what Benedict Carlson called it. Is, let's say we use their terminology, not exactly because the point is that Benedict Carlson is purely real while we are using an anomorphic structure. But let me use their terminology and call this C an approximate critical point. I could call it Cn. And now the limit of all the omega n all the n is going to give us our critical point. Again, I know that is very far from being a definition, but I wanted to give you an idea. To give a formal definition, it really required the construction of these strips, and it's quite involved. It's not very complicated, just it would take a lot of time. Okay, so now we made sense of what a critical point in dimension two is. At least you have a picture. I think that this is the best picture to keep in mind, that you have a point which can be taken as a hook, and this hook moves all over the fundamental domain. And now we can define the coding map also for these points. And if before we were looking at the orbit in the left interval or in the right interval, now we are going to look at the return of this orbit in all these strips which define our partition of the fundamental domain. So our sigma now send x to fi, which is in the partition, the sequences of the partition. And now in particular, we can consider the coding of the critical point. We can consider the, in particular, we can consider also the coding of the limit set, the omega limit set of the critical point. How much time do I have? When am I supposed to finish? In 10 minutes, 15 minutes, right?
Yes.
10 minutes, sort of 10 minutes. Okay, good. Okay, so and now let me give you a definition. And the definition is the following. We say that the two omega, if we take now two maps, two critical points, so that the omega limit of these two critical points is, we call it factor equivalent. So the limit, omega limit of two critical points is this factor equivalent. By definition, if and only if, the two needed sequences are the same. This definition is a bit weaker than the topological definition that we have in dimension one, because this is what it means. It means actually that This implies that the two omega limit sets of the two critical points have a common factor. So what it means to have a common factor, it means that so you have this guy, you do have this other guy. So there exist there exist semiconjugacies. So H and H prime are semiconjugacies, which allowed you to go, so the two are semiconjugated to the same factor. So in the one-dimensional case, we have that the topology is the same, we see that it's the same when the two attractors are conjugated by a conjugacy. Here we something weaker. The problem is that here there are much more critical points, and infinitely many critical points which come to play a role once in a while. So the definition of topology as conjugation with an homeomorphism, it seems really unlikely to happen very often. So that's why we had to weaken a bit our meaning of persistence of topology. Okay, and now finally, I can sit it here. It is with Marco. What we can prove so far is that, so consider the anon family. FAB, so there exists a codimension one lamination L in the parameter space with the following property, such that for all point in the lamination, the corresponding map has a critical point. Now, if we take two guys, which are two points in one leaf of the lamination, then the corresponding limit set are factor equivalent. So in particular, they are conjugated to the same factor, so they persist. So if you take two points on these leaves of these laminations, the topology in this weak definition of topology is going to persist in all the lamination. And the other dimension of the lamination is larger than one. Now there is a second theorem, the same people, which tell that actually there exists another lamination, which I call LCE, which is contained in this lamination, with the property that for all point in this LCE lamination, the corresponding critical point, which we know it exists, is a Kolekma point. Let me just see. So you can find a lamination with the property that, so in the parameter space, with the property that each point on, if you take one leaf, each point on this leaf, so there exists a, correspond to map with a critical point satisfying the Kolekma condition and the omega limit of this critical point a factor equivalent. So their combinatorics move along the leaf. Okay. Okay, so let me make some observations. As I explained to you already, this stability, this persistence of topology is weaker than what we have in dimensional one, but is the one that so far we can control, we can say something that probably the most likely to survive in some way. And then, of course, so notice that remark. We have this critical point, and the limit set of this critical point is contained in the Conley attractor, which is a Conley attractor, but is not, we don't know if it is an attractor. Some of them are attractors, but you know, we don't know. And what we miss is transitivity. So we have Kolekman, we miss transitivity. So So we know that this point, of course, is dense in his limit set, but we don't know if it is dense in all the Conley attractor. This we don't know yet. What we understand is that. So how can we prove this? If we can prove that the Lebesgue measure of this lamination, of this Colecan lamination, is positive, then this would give that also positivity of the transitivity. So sort of be good. There is a very soft argument which from BC. This is the way in which they prove transitivity actually. So if you have Lebesgue measure, positive Lebesgue measure, then you can prove transitivity. And then you would have that on these leaves, there are strange attractors which are topologically the same, which we could actually give a coding of the strange attractor and saying that if you take two strange attractors in the same leaves, they are factor equivalent. So we could start to describe the topology of these chaotic guys. And of course, we expect that the BC points are contained in this lamination. To say is that this Benedict Callison strange attractors actually are contained in this lamination. And what is missed to prove that? So the you see, there is a definition of critical point which is inspired by them, but it uses an holomorphic structure. So the Benedict Callison construction is completely real. So one should prove that the extension of their critical points in the holomorphic setting is degree two, as we define it. So that the two definitions actually match in order to be able to say that these points are really contained in the definition. Okay, so, but this is, again, the theorem is what we know we can prove and which is still lack transitivity. But that's what we would like to do. I don't know how long take and if we never get that. And anyway, just this lecture was a tentative to give you an idea of what we are trying to do, which is understanding the topology and the stability of these chaotic objects. Okay, I think that's what all I wanted to say, and I'm right on time. Wow, fantastic.
So, okay. And, are there any questions for Liliana in the room?
Maybe. Yes.
Yes. I have a couple of questions. So you are talking about codimension two, but you are talking about a non-family, which is two-dimensional. So codimension two doesn't make much sense for this family. Just one point.
I can tell you, should I reply? So when I say codimension two, I mean, again, probably you were not in my previous lectures. That's why you don't know about it. No, it's just for saying that you have to add, codimension two, it means the following, that when you add any number of new parameters at the anon family, so imagine, for example, you take just space of polynomial of any degree, so the points with infinitely many sinks, they form a codimension two manifold. Mm-hmm. That is what.
Yes, so you really think not about a non family, but some larger space containing a non family.
Yes, exactly. But the main point is that these infinitely many sinks which exist that we construct in the non family with their own topology, they are going to survive in larger family, forming these codimension two laminations. Mm-hmm. And this is not going to be destroyed, whatever number of new parameters, whatever large set you, in which any large set you embed your anon family.
Yes, sufficiently regular, of course.
Yeah.
Then next question, I didn't quite understand, because you whether you were talking about the same topology of attractor or the same topology and dynamics on the attractor, because topological conjugacy of the map on the attractor here and here, it's stronger than just saying that that this attractor is homeomorphic to that attractor.
No, yeah, no, I'm talking about topology of attractors because in one dimension these are simpler questions because we know that the attractor is always one. In two dimensions is really is a problem. So for example, if I talk about the Benedict Carlson, we know that it is the only attractor. So we could say that the topology of the attractor is the topology of the dynamics. But most of the case, I'm not ready to say that. So what I control is the topology of the attractor. Also in the case of the period doubling, it is not the topology of the dynamics at all. If you take, actually, if you are at the boundary of case and you take a map nearby, the topology, the dynamics would be completely different. So I'm talking really about topology of attractor, that in some case, if we can say that the attractor is the only one, then we are fine. But the cases in which we can say that are really few. So no, in dimension two, we are not ready to do that.
Yes, but if your attractor, if you have this nicest case that the attractor is the whole, that the closure of the unstable manifold of the fixed point, then I would expect that two of them always have different topology.
Maybe not, in the sense that so I don't know this because I still don't have control on the strange attractor. I still control a very little part of the dynamics, as I miss transitivity. Yeah, still. But the topology, I think, as we describe it in dimension two, in dimension one, I think you are right. But I do believe that this weaken topology, in the sense that there will be factor equivalent. So there is a common factor. They are semi-conjugated to a common factor. This, I believe, that it might be true.
Semi-conjugated on them. Because in general, because here you are kind of taking just one kneading sequence. Yeah. But in general, you should look at infinitely many kneading sequences. We're doing such things with Sonia for lossy maps.
Yeah. So, oh, great. We should talk more about that. Yeah, indeed, there are infinitely many. So you have many, the reason of taking this lower definition, let's say to a weaker definition of topological conjugacy is exactly this, that there are many critical points, there are infinitely many critical points.
Yes.
And all of them, they will start to play a role in one moment or in the other. So you cannot really expect a topological conjugacy.
So we just take factors. Okay. Mm-hmm.
That's what
Thank you. Thank you.
We have a question.
Thank you very much for sharing your nice talk. You had proved that there exists a map in the Hanon family such that it has two strange attractors. Do you think if it is possible to find a map in the Hanon family such that it has three or four or any arbitrary finitely many strange attractors at the same time?
So probably not for a positive measure set of points. Mm-hmm. If it exists, I expect that it's going to be not generic. So it's going to be isolated point. If you want to construct a positive measure set of points with, for example, three strange attractors, mm-hmm. you have to look at a three parameter family. Then you will find that. For two parameters.
What do you think about two parameter families?
I think it's going to be, if they exist, they are isolated points.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, because there is this this result by, so essentially you need the coexistence of many tangencies. Mm-hmm. So, and to have the coexistence, for example, three tangency, you need three parameters. This is, so I can give you the reference later. No,
maybe we can discuss that later. Okay, thank you very much.
Any more questions?
There are other questions.
We don't have questions.
It seems not. Then let's thank Liliana again.
Thanks to you, and again, Felix, happy birthday and all the best.
Let's take a 5-minute break then. Thank you.
Thank you.